Good to be back after a long, not long time. Somebody said I'm long time. Just 2 weeks. Good to be back to the church. And it really, what I'm saying, I really mean it, because back to this church is where you feel home. Okay. All right. So God was good to me, and he enabled me to go meet my brother, and had a good time with him. It was indeed a blessed time of a little relaxation. And after a long time, for the first few days, I was just, just getting up and thinking about church. And then, the Holy Spirit will tell, don't worry, the church will run even you are not there. And I said, okay, Lord, you take care of the church. I will just stand and, pray, or maybe, intercede. Anyways, so it was a good time, and the Lord was good. So I have I was indeed blessed to be there, but at the same time, I was also challenged by a few things which happened. I was sharing with few of our brothers here. Blessed thing was I was able to go and had a good time there. I was able to minister in a few churches. The challenging thing which happened was Christianity is deteriorating in U.S. So I could see that the churches were at one time, they were having 300, 400 people in the U.S. Those churches are now 60, 70s, because now it is all the old people. All the youngsters have actually moved out, because they feel that there is no God, or they feel all this is drama that we are doing in the church. Some of them, they saw that, things are not going the way they wanted, and they want to be a little more cool. So they want to go into the ways of this world, and that was something which challenged me. And I want to challenge the church in New Life Fellowship Church in Dubai. Let's not be casual. You may think at this point of time, my kids are very small. They don't understand things. But let me just tell you, what you are, they will become spiritually. If you value God today, your kids will value God then. If you would sacrifice your life for God, they will do that. Because the time is passing by, and there will be a time when they will tell you, like the family I met, and this young guy of 17, I think. He told his dad told, you need to go to the church. And this guy told in front of me, this guy is telling his dad, oh, that's not cool. That's not cool. That's what they feel at this point of time. And then his dad said, okay, what are you going to do? Well, I'm going to play. All right. So, I want to just challenge you all. Let's not be casual in our spiritual walk. This spiritual walk is more than important than any of the activities that you do. You want your children to have a good future, and you are actually, teaching them, or maybe you are actually, securing their future by giving them good education and stuff. But let me just tell you, the best thing you can give to the children is your walk with the Lord. As I was just thinking when Vinayak was sharing the testimony, the best gift, the best thing auntie, your son have done is to share Jesus to you. And the best gift you have received in your life is to get salvation from the Lord. You can translate it to her later. So the best thing that we can give to our children is, I'm telling you, I'm because I've seen that, is not a good future, a good business. You make him a competent businessman. You give
This child, you make this child talented, skilled, good in language, you can give to your child is Jesus. And if this has not sunk in your heart this morning, let me just one more time push you and tell you, the time is very short. Before it is too late, invest in your children. Invest in your children. And if your child is arrogant, correct him instead of, you know, patting him or patting her and saying, it's okay, you can be arrogant. Correct. Otherwise, the Lord will correct. And it is, Bible says, it is very difficult to fall in the hands of God. So correct the child at the very young age, you know. And I was preaching in one of the youth meeting, and this verse I was telling in the church, and I told this verse. Bible says in Proverbs chapter 22, verse 6, direct your children into the right path when they are young, so that they will not, when they are older, they will not. Bible doesn't say that, you know, you have to direct your children when they become old, so that they will be good. When they are young, at the very young age. All right, so greetings to you in the name of Jesus. And how many of you are feeling sleepy? It's a beautiful climate. It's a beautiful season. Yeah. And I know that it is good to, when the world is enjoying the season, taking selfies, you and me can actually, you know, you and me are here serving the Lord and worshiping the Lord at this point of time, right? So I want to thank you and the passion that you have for the Lord. And I was asking the Lord, and we had this theme of restoration, and some of you have been blessed, some of you already been, you know, moving into that realm, and it is amazing that the Lord is actually doing wonderful things in some of our lives. You know, new year have started, new resolutions, fasting prayer is over. How many of you for fasting? 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. Okay. How many of you are praying? Okay. So, fasting prayer is over. Some have the desire to do something for the Lord. Some are in a maintenance mode. They are thinking, you know, I will just continue as it is. Others are taking life as it is coming. As the life comes, we'll see. Hindi mein bolte hain, jaise aayega, waise dekha jayega. Still others are seriously activating the restoration by standing with God and living by faith. But at some point of time when you know, I always say this, in New Year, your passion will go off at what time? 1 month. So Jan, you are done. So some point we ask this question after we receive the promise from the Lord, and we ask this question, Lord, when? How will this happen? When are you going to move? When are you going to speak to me? And when are you going to fulfill the promises that you have actually promised? And we get tired, and we at times we implement our plans as per our understanding. And that's how we move. And we think this is how the Lord wants to work. But the Lord, His ways are amazing. And we try to implement the plans that we have, and we try to fit God in our mind, and we say this is how the Lord should work. And today, I want to take you through the life of the greatest man in the history. Famous man in the history. Greatest man was definitely Jesus. Famous man in the history, and he was Abraham. How many of you know about Abraham? All right, can I turn your attention to Isaiah chapter 60, verse 22. Isaiah chapter 60, verse 22. This is the promise which is happening right after the restoration. And the Lord is saying, after the restoration, the passage which we read in 58, verse 22, I guess, where the Lord is saying, you know what? Restoration shall rise. Isaiah 60 verse 22 says, the least of you shall become a thousand, and a small one a strong nation. The previous word, verse 22, yes. And in the time I will do it, maybe the NKJ version, and I will hasten it in its time. Okay? I will hasten. So the, if you can put the amplified version, it gives a little more description. It says, the least one shall become a thousand, and the small one shall become a strong nation. I, the Lord, will hasten it in its appointed time. When? Appointed time. Turn to your neighbor and say, God's appointed time. And that's the theme of today's sermon, God's appointed time. And who should hasten it? The Lord should hasten it, not you. Don't actually come and, you know, try to do a shortcut and say, you know what, I think this is how it is going to work, and try to shorten it. Let the Lord hasten it. And that's the reason why I kept this theme as appointed time of the Lord. God has a time for everything. Ecclesiastes chapter 3 verse 1 says it beautifully. Ecclesiastes chapter 3 verse 1 says, for everything there is a season and a time for every matter or purpose under heaven. You can put it in the NIV, which says, NIV. I'm looking for the same verse which says, yes, I don't know which translation was this. Okay. For everything there is an appointed time, that's what it says. And an appropriate time for every activity on. In short, this verse is saying, there is a time which the Lord has kept, the appointed time. Who has appointed this time? The Lord has appointed. It is not the time that you feel it is right. It is not the time that you feel should happen. It is the right time. The Lord should hasten it, and it will come to pass. The Lord has appointed time even for sins. Okay? If you can come with me to Genesis chapter 15, verse 16, it says, in the fourth generation they shall return here, for the time has not come. The appointed time for the Amorites have not yet complete. The same verb is used in the same passage. The appointed time is something that you and me should be looking forward and not get anxious about, and not get, you know, weary in waiting. And today we sang that beautiful song, strength will rise as we wait on the Lord. The Hebrew word for appointed time is called moada, which means a fixed time, which means a fullness of time, which suggests a time of God's choosing, His precise timing. Whose precise timing? God's precise timing. Okay, let me just make this very clear to you. Whenever the Bible talks about the time or the will of God, it always talks about in God's appointed time. Why it is God's appointed time? Because God knows best when this should happen. All right, I hope you're getting me. And I request, by the way, it is a good practice to bring your Bible. I'm not an old-fashioned pastor. It's a good practice to bring your Bible. I know that you can have your iPads and your stuff. It is very easy to click and, you know. But I also found that it is very easy to actually go away from, you know, when you're looking at the Bible and suddenly when notification comes and you're like, oh, let me just check, what is this? This happened to your pastor. That's the reason I'm telling you. And then you are like, within, for 10 minutes, it's, oh, 10 minutes is over. So it is a good practice to have your Bible with you, and you can tell me, Pastor, you know what, I'm actually looking at Bible. You can fool your pastor because your pastor is not very brilliant. Your pastor is not a prophet. But you cannot fool God. So if you're looking at your mobile for Bible, the Lord is saying, if you're looking at your mobile for anything else, or sending a message, or, you know, WhatsApp or Facebook or Instagram, or checking the note, or even checking, some of us are checking the restaurant after this place where we are going. best restaurant in the city. I know some of you are laughing. That was not a prophecy, by the way. That was a random statement. Or maybe, you know, some of the housewives will be thinking about how to cook paneer butter masala today evening for the menu. So that's the reason I told, if you have your mobiles with you, you will have all these distractions. So bring your Bible, because this Bible will not give you any distraction. You will stick to the thing. All right. So God has an appointed time for everything. Let's look at it from the life of Abraham. And the Lord was actually ministering to me as I was actually preparing and, you know, setting this reading this chapter. Verse, come with me to Genesis chapter 17, verse 21. This is the first time in the life of Abraham that the Lord is actually using this word set time. Okay. It says, but my covenant I will establish with Isaac, whom Sarah shall bear to you at this set time. Again, the word what? Moada, which calls appointed time by the Lord. You know, when is this promise? This is just at the age of 99 that he's getting this promise. But when was the time he got the promise? Much before, 25 years before. And this is the time when God is actually telling him that in the appointed time, Abraham, you have done everything possible in your capacity. You have done everything possible to make sure that, you know, you are actually hastening the appointed time. Let me just tell you, Abraham, I will hasten the time, not you. I will do it at the right time, when the time is perfect, when the time is, word says, complete. And the word used in Hebrew is shalem, from the word shalom. The word which means that the time of the Lord's doing, at the right time, he will do it for you. So my first number one point, before that, okay, Genesis chapter 12, we see, actually this I took it from the preaching which happened in the conference, November conference, where the founder president of the college where I studied, he was preaching. He said, God called Abraham out of Egypt and gave him five promises. Write it down, okay? God gave him five promises and one purpose. How many promises? Five promises and one purpose. Okay, let's see. That's in Genesis chapter 12, verse, I think, 1 to 3. God gave him five promises. One, I will make you a great nation. Number two, I will bless you and make your name great. Number three, and you shall be a blessing. Number four, I will bless those who bless you. Number five, and I will curse him who curses you. And what is the purpose? And in you, all the families of the earth shall be blessed. So this was taken, so I wrote it when the preacher was preaching, so I wrote it down. You know, God gave Abraham five promises. Let me just tell you this. Every promise that God has given to you has a purpose. I repeat, every promise of God, which God says that he will do it at his appointed time, has a purpose. Don't think that the purpose is just for you, like Abraham thought it is for him, for his child, for his family. But God's purpose is clear. In verse 3 it says, in you, all the families. First, God will bless you, and then through you, he will bless all the families of the earth. And if this promises which the Lord has given you has not translated into the purposes of God, let me make it very clear to you, you need to rethink about the way that you are going forward. Yes, we have the verse which says that every promises of the Lord are yes and amen in the Lord. Praise God for the context, it's quite different. But it is yes and amen. Praise the Lord. But if this is not translating into the purposes of God, let me just tell you, you are actually not in the very plan which actually God is thinking right now about you. You are maybe having your own plans, not the plan of God. So let me just make this very clear. Five promises when God gives to Abraham, he's also telling him, but my purpose is. And you know what? The Israelites failed. That's the reason God is saying, you know, I have given them a covenant, but they have failed miserably. So I have just 2 points today. We will not go very extended. We will only stop before 12 or maybe, no, 11. Just 2 points. Number one, God's plan is perfect. I don't have the PPT, I wish. I didn't get the time. God's plan is what? Is perfect. God called Abraham before, at the age of 70, God called Abraham, okay? God called Abraham for a perfect plan. And he told Abraham, you know what? The plan is to give you a new identity, a new start, and I will make you a great nation, and you will be a blessing, and in you all the families of the earth will be blessed. And that was the promise that the Lord gave to Abraham in Genesis chapter 12. But you know what he did? He, instead of obeying the Lord, he wanted to take his father and his nephew along with him on the journey. Did God tell him to take all your families? God told him to move out of your father's. Why did God tell him to move out of the father's household? Because all of them were idol worshippers. All of them were what? They were idolaters. Theologians say that they were actually making, or they were like, you know, making idols. That's what, that was their profession. And God said, you know what? I'm not going to make you stand there. You come out of the place and I'm going to show you. You have to go there. But Abraham's plan, the plan of Abraham was, I will take my dad, because you know what? I cannot live without my dad. I will also take the closest, like friend, cousin, what is his name? Lot. The father, let me just tell you, if the plan of God is not for you to do that, they will distract you in your journey. When God took Abraham, Abraham alongside took Terah. Terah said, okay, you know what, let's go to the promised land. So they started from their place in Ur of the Chaldeans to the promised land. Down the way, this father thought, you know what? What is there? Nothing is there. Let me just settle in what? A place called Haran. So that is the place when his father said, this is the promised land for you, Abraham. God spoke to you, but this is the land which the Lord has spoken to you. So you multiply here, you bless the Lord, you do whatever you're going to want to. Go to church, do whatever you wanted to do it. This is the place. But you know what God had to do? God had to take his life. Because he was trying to hasten the plan of God. It is written, this was not in the script, but it is written in Genesis, after I think 12 or 13, it is written, after Terah, the father of Abraham, died, the word of the Lord came to Abraham. To what? To move forward. He did not learn even then. So he said, okay, you know what? My father is dead. Nobody is close to me. Nobody can understand me. Let me just do one thing. Let me take my cousin. What is his name? Lot. He means a lot to me. I cannot live without him. And he tried to actually make things a little more easier. And what happened? He took Lot along with him to the promised land. You know what happened to Lot? God had to bring what? A division. And you know what happened to Lot? There was a dissension between Lot's men and Abraham. And then Abraham had to say, okay, you know what? If you're going that side, I'm going this side. If you're going that side, I'm going this side. Now the Lord told him, now move. So Abraham's life was, from the very beginning, his plan was different. And God told him, this is one plan which, you know, he had, and God actually had to do so many things to bring him to the Canaan, to the promised land. Second plan, God told him, I will give you a son, and that son will be yours. Come with me to Genesis chapter 15, verse 2. When God is giving him this plan, Abraham's plan was what? Lord, what will you give me? I'm childless. Oh, I think it is what? I think it is Eliezer who is going to be the most powerful man. And his plan was Ishmael, Genesis chapter 17, verse 18. Genesis 17, verse 18. Abraham said to the Lord, oh, that Ishmael might live before you. When God's plan is for you better or the best thing, Abraham was settling in. That's the reason we saw that, you know, he was settling in for something which was not the plan of God, which was definitely not what the Lord has intended for him. He wanted to settle in for something little, less better, but God had something best for him. And that's the reason why we see when Abraham's plan was Eliezer, when Abraham's plan was Ishmael, God's plan was Isaac. I repeat, when Abraham's plan was Eliezer and his plan was Ishmael, God's plan was what? Isaac for him, and which he couldn't see it. There is no wonder why he didn't see it. Just imagine at the age of 70, or just, okay, today, you are 20, and at the age of 20, you are getting a promise from the Lord, and then the promise happens at the age of 50. Will you like it? Will you like it? You'll be like, Lord, I think I just overheard God, you know. I don't think this plan is good. So number one point, God's plan is perfect. Number two, God's time period is perfect. 2 points, remember this, just 2 points today. God's plan is perfect. God's time period is perfect. At 70, God called Abraham. At the age of 70, God called Abraham. At the age of 72, God promised him a child, that you will have a child. And when he was 85, that is 13 years have passed, he is now 85 years old. The promise did not materialize. The promise did not happen yet. 13 years have passed after the promise. At 85, in Genesis chapter 16, he decides to implement the plan by himself. So he thought, maybe, I think this is the best. So what his wife said? Okay, you know what, you do this. And you can go through that entire chapter. It is written how this plan was implemented. And you know what happened? They failed miserably. As the expression goes, he finally came to himself and told his wife, do whatever you want. At 85, 13 years after the promise he received, he was wary and he was thinking, I don't think this is going to happen. I think there is some mistake. I think God would have intended this person in my life. Or maybe God would have thought about this thing. You may be at whatever age, I don't care. But if the Lord has promised you a promise, let me just make it sure it is going to happen. It doesn't matter how old you are. It doesn't matter what circumstance you are in. It doesn't matter how you are going to move forward. If the Lord has promised this promise to you, make sure it will happen in the appointed time. Somebody say with me, an appointed time. Not the time that I think is best, but the appointed time of the Lord. And at 85, after 13 years, he's actually getting restless. He's thinking, you know what, I'm getting old. My wife is getting old. I don't know how this plan, how this promise is. Some of us are in this maintenance mode. We think, we try to help God. We think that this is how it should be. It's like I went to my brother's place, and he has three children. The first one said to me, I was taking my iPad and I was doing something. She comes to me and she's, I think, 6 or 7. She said, this is not how you should operate your iPad. I will tell you how to do that. This is sometimes we do it for the Lord. Lord, you know what? This is not how you should actually work it out. I know the plans. I know how better we can do it. My appointed time. But God says, not your appointed time, it is my appointed time. And at the age of 99, when he came to himself, when he understood that things are not the way he is actually thinking, Genesis chapter 17, verse 1, the word of the Lord come to him again, When? At what age? When he was 99 years old. When all the thing is gone. His wife is making a statement, at this age, I will get pleasure. At the age of what? 19. That's what his wife is saying. And Abraham, he knew at this point of time that this is impossible because he is old. He cannot even stand up. He cannot even talk properly. At this age, at 99 years, the Lord appeared to Abraham and said to him, I am God. Sometimes this revelation is very much needed in our life. When we think that it should happen our way, and we trust in our ability, we trust in our, you know, skills, and we think, I know how to do things, and God had to actually bring you to the point where you will come to yourself, and God will say, you know, now I will work. Sometimes this delaying in the promise is so that you will, I preach this message, when God is actually not doing some healing into your life, when God is not doing some restoration in your life, it is not because he is not able. He is actually making you able so that you will be able to trust in the Lord. Amen. So in this middle of your promises, don't get weary. Trust in the Lord. And as we heard today, wait in the Lord. So at the chapter 17, God told Abraham at the age of 99. The last time God told him the promise was at the age of 72, that I will give you a son. Now God is telling Abraham, you know what? I am Almighty God. I am your God. I know what to do. I am Almighty. The Hebrew word we all normally say is El Shaddai. That's a word used there. God is saying, I am El Shaddai. I am all powerful. I can move mountains. You just have to walk before me blameless. But I will move mountains for you. I will do things. I will give you child. I will give you things that you've been dreaming of. You've been praying of. I will do that. You do your part. Don't get weary. Stand with God and activate your restoration. Stand with God and say, Lord, not my time, but your appointed time. At the age of 100, God's promises were fulfilled. Come with me to chapter 18. Chapter 18, that's the second time this word is used, appointed time. God is saying in 18, chapter 18, verse 14, is anything too hard for the Lord? I want to bring these promises to you this morning of the new year of 2023. Let me challenge you by asking this question. Is there anything hard for my Lord? Reply to him. Is there anything hard for my Lord? The Lord is asking this question to Abraham. Is there anything hard for the Lord? At the appointed time. Somebody say with me, appointed time. I will make it happen. Hallelujah. How many of you are waiting for that appointed time? You can actually, you know, wait, or you can actually get involved and implement and act God, and you can actually do the way, like how Abraham did, implement things in his way and then miserably fail, and then, you know, your entire life struggling. And you have to, in one point of time, Abraham had to send Hagar and Ishmael out of the house, not once, twice. Once, when she was having this small, the child was very small. And it is written in Genesis, at one point of time, Abraham sent Hagar and Ishmael away to live in a certain place. His entire life, he would be thinking, you know, why I did that? Let me just say something. This is something which I actually was thinking. Look at Abraham's failure. Abraham was willing, I'm a little blunt here, was willing to let his wife do wrong things with another man by saying that Sarah is my sister. Genesis chapter 12, verse 13 says, look at this. Please say that you are my sister, that it will go well with my sake. And he didn't do it once, he did it twice. Genesis chapter 20, verse 2. The second time he did it again. Abraham said to Sarah, his wife, she is my sister. You know the repercussions? Genesis chapter 16, his wife allowed Abraham to sleep with a maid. Their generation is over. Much later in Genesis chapter 26, his son, 26 verse 7, his son Isaac said the same thing what his father did. I told you when I started this message, you may think my children, they're not even looking, they're not even seeing, it's okay, I can actually gossip about my that fellow to my child, I can put this person down in front of my child, I can talk about all these, you know, bad things about the other people to my child. Let me just tell you, one day it will come back to you. His son did the exact same thing what his father did it years back. Years back, even when Isaac was not there, years back. Look at this. He's saying, he said, she's my sister, for he was afraid to say, she's my wife, because the men will kill me, because Rebecca was very beautiful. What should we do when we are actually going through this waiting period? What should we do? And we read that verse today. And I want to actually say that Isaiah chapter 40 verse 31. This is how you should activate your restoration. Those who wait on the Lord shall renew. Or maybe in other words, restore their strength. And they shall mount up with wings like eagles. They shall run. They will not be weary. And they shall walk and they will not faint. And this is the promises of God to each one of us. Yes, he gives the promises. He also tells you to wait. Number one, what shall I do in that appointed time of God to fulfill? Number one, wait. Number two, act. And that's something which I want to bring. Come back to Genesis chapter 17. God told him, okay? And this is very, very funny. In Genesis chapter 17, God is telling him when he asks, you know, I don't have a child. Verse 17 says, God told, by the way, verse 15, God's saying, you know, your wife shall be called as Sarah, because I will bless her and I'll give her a son, and she will be called as the mother of nations. Kings shall come from her. And verse 17, Abraham fell on his face and prayed. When I was small, my dad used to say, kneel down and pray. So we used to kneel down and sleep. And when the amen comes, we don't hear that. And my dad, hello, amen. And then we're like, amen, amen, amen. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Jesus. Same thing Abraham is doing. He fell on his face to worship the Lord. No, he fell on his face to what? Just imagine, I was just thinking. He did like this and... That's what he did. That's not what I made it. That's what it is written there. Abraham fell on his face, and you will expect him, and he offered sacrifice. Lord, great are you, Lord. No. He just fell on his face and he laughed. Shall a child be born to a man who is 100 years old? And shall Sarah, who is 90 years old, shall bear a child for me? He's laughing. Genesis chapter 18 verse 12, his wife is laughing. Look at this. The next chapter 18 verse 12. Therefore, come from verse 11. Okay. Now Abraham and Sarah were old, well advanced in age, and Sarah had passed the age of childbearing. Therefore, Sarah what? Laughed within herself, saying, I have grown old. Shall I have what? Pleasure at this very old age? My Lord being, he is also old. So will this ever happen? Verse 13. The Lord says to Abraham, why did Sarah laugh? But the Lord did not ask Abraham, why did he laugh? I'll come back to it. The Lord said to Abraham, why did Sarah laugh? Shall I surely bear a child? This is what she is thinking. And verse 14, that's how the background of the verse that we took, is there anything hard for the Lord? She, it is written there, verse 15, Sarah denied it that I did not laugh. She was afraid. That's the reason why God did not actually punish her. This was not her unbelief. This was actually what? She was afraid and she said, no, I did not laugh. So Abraham laughed. Sarah laughed. And you know what happened? At the end, God laughs. And he gave them a son. And the name of the son was what? Anybody knows what is the meaning of the word Isaac? Abraham laughed at the very beginning, thinking at this very old age, how will things happen? Sarah laughed because of the inability. But later, God is laughing at them because God gave the name of Isaac. And his name was laughter. God was just thinking, I was thinking, God would have been sitting there. Achha beta, tum log has rahe ho na, abhi dekho main hasta hu. Abhi dekho main hasta hu. Naam rakho uska. Kya naam hai? Isaac. Isaac means laughter. Yeah, keep that name. You are laughing. No, keep that name for him. At the appointed time, the Lord actually, but act. So I said wait, and second is act. You know, in chapter 17, he is laughing. Verse 17, Genesis 17, 17, Abraham is laughing. But God said, you know what? It will happen to you. I will bless even Ishmael. Verse 20, I will make him fruitful even. I will multiply him. He will also become a great nation. But my covenant is with Isaac, whom Sarah shall bear at the appointed time next year. Verse 22 says, when the Lord finished talking with Abraham, God went up from Abraham. Okay? Now verse 23 says, Abraham took Ishmael his son and all who were born in the house and all who were brought with his money, every male among the men of Abraham's household, circumcised the flesh of their foreskins. The word says, the very same day. Yes, I preach this message, activate your restoration. Doesn't mean that you just have to sit in the place and just relax. Yes, you have to relax in the Lord. But you need to do something which the Lord has asked you to do the very same day. You can sit, you can start this year you can start this year by saying, it will come, I will take it as it comes. Whatever comes in life, it's okay. You can be in a maintenance mode. You can be in a mode where you can say, you know what, I don't know if this is going to happen. Or you can even say that things are not the way that I planned it. Or you can also say, you know what, let the life comes. I will do whatever it takes. Or you can do like Abraham the very same day, which shows that he was serious about God. He believed in God, that at the age of 99 also God is able to do what? To give him a promise. Can I request the worship team to come forward? Can I request all of you to rise in your place? He is faithful. Genesis chapter 21 verse 1. And this is something which the Lord has fulfilled. He said, the Lord visited Sarah as he had said. And the Lord did for Sarah as he had spoken. Verse 2, for Sarah conceived and bore Abraham a son in his old age. What is a set time? At the set time of which the Lord has spoken to him. What is appointed time which the Lord has given? The appointed time of the Lord. At what age? At the age of 99. At the age of 100. If that is a set time for the Lord, he is able to do that even at the age of 99. It doesn't matter how old are you. If the Lord has spoken to you, he will fulfill it. If God has promised you something, you will have to wait for his fulfillment. It can be a day for you. For some, it can be a week. For some it can be a month. Some it can be even a lifetime. Like Abraham, it was 100 years before his promised son was born. Some of us will not even see the fruit of our waiting until the very next life. Like Abraham did not even live long enough to see his offspring become a nation. He did not see that happen in his lifetime. But he definitely saw it in the next life. Let me just encourage you this morning. The message have come, restoration is happening, but what can I do? As David says, Lord, I will lift up the cup of salvation and I will worship you. I will not sit in disbelief and in doubt and in implementing my own plans. I will act like how Abraham acted. He could have been easily get discouraged because the Lord told him last time also. The Lord told him twice, thrice, been 25 years. Nothing has happened and I am old, I'm not capable. The Lord has said it will happen, then it will happen. And that's a promise for each one of you. God's surprising revelation to Abraham when he was completely unable, or even his wife completely barren. But as soon as the Lord left by saying these promises, Abraham immediately set about obeying God's command to circumcise himself and every male in the household as a sign of the covenant with the Lord. In other words, he was saying, I trust in you, Lord. And that's the reason why we have the verse in 12 that this was set for him as righteousness. He believed in God, and this was actually kept for him as righteousness. This is the time, church, if you want to speak to the Lord. If there is some promises that you have been waiting and waiting and waiting and waiting and waiting, there is an appointed time that the Lord has kept for you. And all his promises are yes and amen.
Amen.
And those promises are not dependent on your skills or your time or your background of your or your circumstance or the job or the salary or the people around you. It doesn't depend on that. The promises of God are yes and amen in him, in the Lord. Because he is even able to make anything out of nothing. Let me just sing this song, Strength Will Rise, as we wait upon the Lord. And as we wait upon the Lord with expectation, let's do these two things. One, wait, and second, act. Not act in our strength, but act in ways that the Lord has asked us to obey. Strength will rise as we wait
upon the Lord. We will wait upon the Lord. We will wait upon the Lord.
I say it by meaning.
Strength will rise as we wait.
Declare
upon
it.
The Lord. We
declare
will
it
wait
this day.
Upon the Lord. We will wait upon the Lord.
Our God, you reign forever.
He's an El Shaddai God. He's a God who sees.
A strong deliverer.
He's a God who moves. He's a God who can do things in your life.
You are the everlasting God.
God who is able.
The everlasting God. You do not faint to one. Grow weary.
He never sleeps nor slumbers.
Comfort those
who are in need.
strength will rise as we wait upon the Lord. We will wait upon the Lord. We will wait upon the Lord. Strength will rise as we wait upon the Lord. We will wait upon the Lord. We will wait upon the Lord. Our God, who reigns forever, our hope, our strong deliverer. You are the everlasting God, the everlasting God,
the Almighty God, the El Shaddai God. Worship you, Lord, for this day. Thank you, God, that you are an everlasting God. You are an almighty God, El Shaddai God. You're a God who sees, Ebenezer God. And God, this day as we activate our restoration, we pray, God, that you may help us, that we will not become weary, but we will wait upon the Lord. For our strength is not on this world, but our strength is in the Lord.
Amen.
And Lord, we stand and declare it this day as we activate this restoration. Lord, that you are going to move because you are able. I am not able, Lord. I am not able, but you are able. And I pray, God, that there is anybody here have been in the barren situation of their life. It's a dead end for their life. They have been waiting. They have lost hope. They have been weary, and I pray that you may infuse this strength of the Lord, the power of the Holy Spirit in them right now in the name of Jesus. That the strength will rise and they will wait upon the Lord, and they will get the promise that they have got from the Lord, and it is yes and amen. And I pray, God, that you may start moving in their life in your appointed time. Not in the time that I'm thinking right now, but in the appointed time of the Lord, it shall happen. I, the Lord, shall make it happen. Thank you, Lord, for your promises. Thank you, God, that you're going to do this powerful thing in the coming days, years, or maybe months, or maybe, Father, Lord, I don't know, but you're going to do it in your appointed time, oh Father. Like you did in the life of Abraham, you did it. That's what we read at this set time you have appointed. It happened. And Lord, in the coming days, you will have testimonies that the Lord has made it happen.
Hallelujah. Thank you, Lord.
We give you all glory and honor. For you deserve it, O Lord. We are frail. And Lord, that we are unable. But there's a God who stands behind us, and he says, he thumps in with this declaration that I am able. I can do anything. Thank you for the promises. We give you glory and honor. In Jesus' most precious name we pray. Can we all just lift up our hands and go with the benediction? Now may the love of God, grace and mercy of Jesus, sweet fellowship of the Holy Spirit, enable each one of us as we wait upon the Lord and as we act in obedience for the promises that he has given. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen and amen. Put our hands together for the Lord. Have a great week and have a great fellowship. God bless you all.